thing. I'm on, right? Turned on. Book of Hebrews again tonight. Hebrews, if you, does anybody need a study guide of the study guides we have up here? Does anybody need one to have one? There's two sheets there, Isaac. The front and back. Two sheets. Yeah, that's it. Anybody else need one? Did not get one. All right. Very good. Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3 is our fourth study in the book of Hebrews tonight. Basically, this would be one of the chapters in Hebrews. As I gave you my introduction 3 or 4 weeks ago, anybody remember why it was Paul wrote the book of Hebrews? He wrote the book of Hebrews so that he would tell them not to be Hebrews. Don't be Hebrews. Be Christians. You're too much, you're being too Jewish. You're putting Jewish ahead of Christianity. So that's why he wrote the book of Hebrews. So in chapter 3 tonight, which we will focus on here in a moment, he kind of gets more into that, and kind of they get all off base, and they forgot that they're saved now, and they don't have to do all that ritualism and all that other stuff. So tonight, I'd like to preach the kind of the study guide that's in front of you, number four study, Jesus Will Satisfy. So Great Salvation is the name of the study. Jesus Will Satisfy is the fourth part tonight in Hebrews chapter 3. Let's go ahead and have a word of prayer before we get into the study guide tonight. Amen. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to be here. Lord, we know we're missing a lot of people that are sick and don't feel good, out of town, all kinds of different things going on in their lives. Lord, we just pray that you bring them all back to us this coming Sunday morning, Lord, that we fill up your house for your glory, you know, that the Christians will be edified, souls will be saved, and people be added to the church, Lord. We just pray that you bring everybody back. And then the ones that are here tonight, Lord, I pray that you'll bless them and that we will be a blessing to all that have gathered here tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I'd like to go ahead and read the first six verses of chapter 3 and kind of set up the message tonight. And it's Paul talking to brand new, you got to get the text and get the context of the text, okay? But it's the Apostle Paul talking and preaching, you know, he's preaching, but he's talking to them at least, for the very least, to brand new Jewish Christians, okay? Remember, they're Jewish Christians, not just Christians. These are, hardcore, they were hardcore Jews. I mean, proud of it. I don't even know if I've ever met some Jewish people, but they're all very, very proud of their heritage. They are. That's just how they are. So here's the Apostle Paul, and he's talking to this group, and this is what he said. Wherefore, holy brethren, remember now, see, he calls them brethren, so he's saying that you are saved. Holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus, who was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. For this man was counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he hath builded the house, hath more honor than the house. For every house is builded by some man, but he that built all things is God. And Moses fairly was faithful in all his house as a servant for a testimony of those things which were to be spoken after. But Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house are we, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end. In the early days of the church, nearly all who came to Christ were Jewish people. Remember that. It's a very important fact that we always forget. But the people that were getting saved in the very early days of the church were all Jews. Being a Jew has as much to do with your relatives as it does with your religion. One is born a Jew, raised a Jew. To a Jew, Judaism is a way of life. It dictates such things as what you can eat, what days of the week you can work, who you can marry. But however, when a Jew understands that Christ is the Messiah, his Savior, a lot changes. He becomes a believer, trusting Christ as the sacrifice for his sins, buried and risen on the third day. Now, back in the first century, this was all brand new stuff. This was brand new. The Jewish Christians, it was brand new. They had never been through this kind of thing before. And they were coming to Christ, but they didn't stop being Jewish. They still circumcised their sons 8 days after birth. They still ate kosher foods. They went to the synagogue on Saturday and worshiped at the church house on Sunday. That's the way it was for about the first 8 or 10 years of Christian history. Jewish believers winning other Jewish people to Christ. Then, primarily through the missionary labors of Paul, Gentiles began to be won to Christ, and thoroughly Christian churches were established all over the Roman Empire. Just regular, old, Gentile churches. Nothing to do with the Jews. Amen? And these believers did not observe Jewish customs and laws. They liked their pork. They liked bacon. Conducted business on the Sabbath. And they did not circumcise their sons. And the stage was set for the first doctrinal dispute in the history of the first century church. Take your Bibles and go to the book of Acts chapter 15 and read with me the first two verses, and you'll see what is about to, the reason why that Hebrews chapter 3, the first six verses was written, was because of this dispute which was going on between the Gentiles and the Jews. They're all saved. They just have a difference of opinion. That sounds like a bunch of Baptists, don't it? All right. And certain men, that's chapter 15, verse 1, and certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, you can't be saved. Now verse 2. When therefore Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain other of them should go up to Jerusalem unto the apostles and elders about this question. You mean we don't? You have to. We're Gentiles and we're supposed to be circumcised and eat the different diet and go to the synagogue on the Sabbath on the Saturday, and there was a big dispute going on. So basically, these teachers said, it's good that you have Christ. You have need to mix a little Moses with your faith, though. You've got to put Moses with him. You must be circumcised and keep the law, and only then can you be first-class Christians. So to resolve this issue, a conference was held at the church in Jerusalem centering on the question, was something more than Christ necessary to complete the experience of salvation? Now, you might think that this was just a Bible contention back in the first century between Jewish Christians and the Gentile Christians. But let me tell you something. There's all kinds of Christian sects today, all kinds of Christian beliefs today, and many of them will tell you, well, there's one group that if you don't get baptized, you're not saved. There's another group that says that there's 17 heavens. If you get saved, you can be your own God. And I mean, there's all kinds of really weird belief systems out there. Jesus plus other things equals saved. That's not what the Bible said. So the Apostle Paul set forth to get this thing straightened out, amen? So that's the issue addressed tonight in our text in Hebrews. Christ is all you need to make your spiritual experience complete. He's all you need. Jesus Christ. Don't add anything. Don't take anything away. Just Jesus. Just Jesus. Amen. And by the way, there's even a group out there called Just Jesus. I mean, and they get pretty whacked out too. I'm telling you, stick with your Bible. Stick with your Bible. There's many of these are issues today. Many teach that things such as baptism, keeping the commandments, observing the Sabbath, speaking in tongues, performing sacraments, complete the experience of salvation, and improve your spiritual condition. If you don't do these extra things, you're not saved. That's sad, isn't it? So these Jewish believers had Jesus. They had it all. They had everything they needed. But they added Judaism, and they messed it all up. So go back to Hebrews, if you will, back to Hebrews chapter 3. That will be our text tonight. And these Jewish believers had Jesus. To emphasize that nothing more was needed, Apostle Paul reminds them of three things tonight. I'm going to give you three things on your paper tonight. Three things. Number one on your sheet, what they had become. They were something different. They were saved. 100%. Not just 75. Not just 65. They didn't need a helping of this and a helping of that. When you get saved, you're saved all the way. Look at verse 1, the first part. How the Apostle Paul, he breaks right into this argument. And he comes out with a statement right here in verse 1. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling. You already got it. You've already got it. You're already partakers of the heavenly calling. You already got saved. Amen. They were the holy brethren. If you're saved tonight, maybe you may not even be baptized. Can I say to you tonight, I'm not saying that you shouldn't get baptized. Don't get me wrong. The preacher said, Baptist church, you shouldn't get baptized. Don't leave here saying that tonight. That's not what I'm saying. But what I want to say to you is, baptism isn't going to save you. And if you got saved and never got baptized in your whole life, you'd still go to heaven. You'd still go to heaven. These, Paul says, were holy brethren. They were brethren because they belonged to the family of God. On your sheet, the family of God. They had been born again of incorruptible seed, the Word of God. In 1 Peter 1:23, it says, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible by the Word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. They had been born sons of Israel. By faith, they were now sons of God. Listen, they were always going to be sons of Israel. But if you don't get saved, you will not be a son of God. Convinced by the Word of God that Jesus was the Savior, trusting Him for their salvation, they had become children of God, members of God's family. Jesus was all that they needed to become a son of God. They were holy brethren because they were one with Christ. One with Christ. Go back in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 11. Chapter 2, verse 11. And it says, for both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all of one. Now who is he that sanctifieth? Who is he that is sanctified? And the Bible says we are what? All of one. In Christ, the believer is holy and without blame before God. In Christ. We are holy not because of a perfect performance, not because you're this greatest person in the world and you can do anything you want, no, but a perfect position. Your perfect position is that you're all of one in Christ, as the Scripture says. So there's, first of all, there's positional holiness. Don't get hung up on this, but I want to explain this. Positional holiness. It refers to our standing in Christ, which is perfect, permanent, and based solely on the work Christ has done. It's based on what He has done, not we have done. And number two, there's practical holiness, and it refers to our separation from the world, which is progressive and may not be permanent because it depends on us, what we do as a Christian. So it's progressive. It means it comes and it goes. That's what that means. So we're holy brethren. Number two, partakers of a heavenly calling. See, here's the rub, if you want, or here's the comparison tonight. The Jew had an earthly calling, okay? The Jew has an earthly calling. He was to live in the promised land. He worshiped at a temple built with human hands. He looked for an earthly kingdom governed by the coming Messiah. All the blessings were primarily associated with earthly things. On the other hand, though, the Christian possesses a heavenly calling. The differences are many. Look at the chart in front of you on your sheet there. The earthly calling, their blessings came from being in the land, the Jews. Heavenly calling, our blessing comes from being in the Lord. The Jews, their blessings were attached to the place Canaan. Number two, our blessings are in a person, Christ, not in a place. Number three, the Jews were governed by law. The Christian has received life. The Jew was given a religion. Christians have received a relationship. Their religion was based upon doing things. Our relationship is based upon just being done. When we get saved, we're done. I mean, as far as going to heaven, we're done, but we're not done with our walk with God. But as far as we're sealed until the day of redemption, we are going to go to heaven. The Christian has no need of a temple, of rituals, or worship. He has no holy city called Jerusalem. Yeah, that's the holy city, right? He is a pilgrim. See, the Jews have a place. They're gonna look to Jerusalem. But we are looking to the new Jerusalem. We're looking upwards. Amen. We're a pilgrim on this earth, one with Christ of heaven, headed for the city whose builder and maker is God. Number two, whom they were replacing. These people were Jews, but Paul had to convince them whom they were replacing in verses 1, the second half, down to verse 5. Consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus. He is the apostle of our profession, the one in whom we profess faith. An apostle is a messenger sent from God. Jesus was sent from God to be man's Savior. He came to seek and to save that which is lost, to give His life in payment for sin, that we might have life and have it more abundantly. Number two, He is the high priest of our profession. The high priest who was faithful, verse 2, to Him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. For this man was counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he hath builded the house, hath more honor than the house. A priest is a mediator to offer sacrifices, to intercede to God on behalf of man. But on the other hand, Jesus is the great high priest of the Christian faith. He is the priest. He's the great priest. He's the number one priest. There is no other priest. There is no other one. There's no one that we have to worry about except the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. He lives forever seated at the right hand to make intercession for us. Secondly, so Christ was compared to Moses in our scriptures. Moses was faithful, but he was only a servant in the house of God, but God made the house. I like the way the Apostle Paul words that, amen? Moses is honored throughout all the scriptures, mentioned so many hundreds and hundreds of times, but he was just a man serving in the house of God. Christ was also fruitful, but as a son over his own house. Can you imagine how humble, how much he had to humble himself? In the Bible, remember last week we said he became lower than the angels? How he could do that, how he could even do that, is just beyond comprehension for our little brain. As the Son of God, he was over the house Moses served in. The point in the text is that Moses and his laws was underneath Christ. He was not to supersede Christ. Moses was not to be over Christ. Moses was a great man. The Lord loved Moses, one of the greatest men in all of the Bible. And yet, he was in the house of God. He was not over the house of God. See, Christianity is littered with men and their doctrines, of people that have been bigger than God. I've even seen great men of God that were absolutely straight as an arrow. Get off the track in their preaching and in their teaching. Get all whacked out in their older years, some over money, some over other things, and end up ruining the greatness that they had as a young man when God called them to preach. We're never bigger than God. No matter who we are, I've never wanted to be that. I never wanted to be ever bigger than the church. This church, what this church stands for, the Bible, the Lord, everything that this whole place stands for, it's all about Jesus. It's always been about Jesus. Christianity is littered with men and their doctrines that have superseded Christ. Think about it. Mormonism, the teachings of Joseph Smith, who got defrocked as a Methodist preacher, and so he went out in the woods and he met the angel Moroni, who gave him the golden tablet so he can rewrite the Bible. And then he had to write down the pearl of great price. It actually is the first one he wrote. Later on, he wrote the Book of Mormon. The Book of Mormon is just total trash. That was just how he had to justify all these weird teachings so then he could make the Jews went to America, and then they founded the Jews in America. No, just tobacco stuff. Then there's the Jehovah's Witnesses, founded by Charles Taze Russell, another guy that was whacked out. He was defrocked by a Christian organization and went out and rewrote his own stuff. I mean, they actually tried to kill him a couple times, but he kept going. You know, he even died and he almost fizzled out. And another guy who was underneath him brought back all of his teaching and started teaching it again. And that's why the people that, if you call a Jehovah Witness today a Russellite, they'll deny it totally to the bitter end. We're not anything to do with John Taze Russell, because this other guy took over and he kind of finished what John Taze Russell started and became the Jehovah's Witnesses. You know that Catholicism, I mean, there's a little bit of good stuff there, and it is, you know, Jesus Christ is in there, but it's the priests. And by the way, and you know, if you talk to the American Catholics, they're a lot closer to the Christian church than they ever used to be. They got rid of a lot of those things that they do over in Europe, but they still do them in Europe. Priests are the person that replaces Jesus Christ, and they're the father of the faith, and you confess to them, and a pope is speaks for Jesus. Come on now. Mary is raised higher than Jesus, and they're very, very tricky about it too, and they don't put it out there where you can really catch it unless you're really watching for it. But even in some of those the movies that they put out, and the Passion of Christ was, by the way, a very Catholic movie, and there the seven stations of the cross are all outlined out in that movie if you watch for them. And there's one place in that movie where Jesus is just about to die and go to the cross and everything, and he looks at Mary and gets her permission. You got to catch all that. Got to catch all that. I mean, Catholicism is, they just mix a lot of good stuff with a lot of bad stuff, and they mix it all together. Then you have the charismatics, and man, they preach Jesus Christ. They preach salvation. And I mean, if sometimes you hear them preaching, man, they're right on it. And they're just the good stuff. And some of those Pentecostal preachers are better than the Baptists anyway. The way they preach, they just can preach. But then they get off on this other stuff, the tongues and the miracles and the prophecies and getting slain in the spirit. And my dad didn't know any better. And what is the name of that group? There's this one group of, hardcore Pentecostal, hardcore charismatics. And my dad didn't know it. And he set me up and he said, Bill, you should go over and preach to those guys and be a part of that sometime. And I'll get you all set up. And so I'm thinking, I don't know about this. And I get the name, Brother Charlie, you would know the name. It's a kind of a holiness kind of group. I mean, they're hardcore. I mean, slain in the spirit, the whole thing. And the guy approved me. He said, come on in. We want to hear you preach. And I went over and I ate breakfast with him and didn't know a soul there, not nobody. And then after I got done preaching, they all got excited about it and everything. And this guy got up and he started praying and they started speaking in tongues. And then some guy got up and they hit him in the forehead and he collapsed on the floor. And I mean, oh my word, where am I at? And I got pretty nervous about this time. I mean, it just got really different. And I thought, well, I never made fun of him. I really did. I didn't say a word. Matter of fact, I wanted to see what that was all about. I wanted to check it out. I was observing, I'm just kind of checking it out. But it is definitely, it is, you just don't find that stuff in our Bible. Amen. All right, number three tonight, and I just got off track there just a little bit, not too bad. Number three, what the consequences would be if these people, didn't change their ways. And in verse 6, we see the second part says, but Christ, as a son over his own house, whose house are we, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm unto the end. So these brethren were genuine, they were the real deal, amen? So they weren't in danger of losing anything. The Apostle Paul was very, by the way, be very careful with people of other faiths, and there's a good chance they really, really get saved, even despite the bad doctrine, despite the bad teachings. You just don't know. So be very careful. I mean, don't go criticize another man's faith until you, you can, if they open the door, you can walk through. Hey, that's the way I approach it. If they open the door and they ask me, then I'll tell them, amen? And I tell them how I feel and what the Bible says, and then that's a different story. Nobody wins when you argue and you fuss and you get in a big fight and then you're fighting about the Bible. I mean, come on, that just doesn't work, amen? But these brethren, they were the genuine thing. But when Christians exchange Christ for a form of religion, the faith that saved them goes no farther. That's the problem, see? Here's the problem with people with bad doctrine, even though they're really, truly saved. I mean, maybe some very good, saved Catholic people. But they're in a church that's not teaching them the right way. It's not teaching them the Bible. Amen. Okay. So let's just go at it from that point of view. So what they need is they need discipled. They need taught the Word of God. Amen. They can't go any further. They won't learn about what God, all the blessings of God in the Bible for them. They don't know any of that. They won't grow in the Lord. But when Christians exchange Christ for a form of religion, the faith just won't go any further. But on the other hand, future generations come to trust in, sometimes they trust in creeds instead of Christ. Amen? Performing rituals replaces a personal relationship with Christ. And here's what happened in the world. They have become denominations. How many denominations? Let's just use the word Baptist. How many denominations of Baptist? Does anybody know, is it like 800 kinds of Baptists in America? Something like that. I mean, it's way up there. Why? Why not just preach the Bible? Why not just get into the book and just teach what the Bible says and forget about what man thinks? Amen? I mean, it gets really weird out there, amen? So we got to be careful not to have a religion. Instead, have a relationship with Christ. And so tonight we need to make sure that we have trusted in Jesus Christ for our salvation, not something else. And there's all kinds of really good things out there that we would think might save us, but only the blood of Christ. That's the only thing that'll save us. Amen. Christ plus anything. Put this formula down. Write it in your write in the front cover of your Bible. Christ plus anything equals nothing. Christ plus that'd be a great poster on the wall in a Baptist church. Christ plus anything equals nothing. Has someone told you somewhere along the way that you need something more than Jesus? I've been told that. Growing up, got all mixed up. Wandered around in the desert for a while before the Lord got a hold of me. Found out I was truly saved. I just was, you know, just unaware of, just got all mixed up. Amen. Some people even think that the church saves. I mean, you know, church membership and all that, but, you know, not even that will save you. Some people think that their experience. Well, I had an experience. Well, I had an experience too. I had an experience with Jesus. Greatest experience I ever had. I don't have to have an experience every week. I had it that one time. Amen. That's how it should be. So, when you go home tonight, read these verses again. Hebrews chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. And remember what you've become. Holy partakers of the great gift God gave us through Jesus Christ. Remember whom you would be replacing, what the consequences would be. Remember never to have a false confidence, a counterfeit joy, or a vain hope. Do we have the Christ of heaven tonight? I guess it's the question I would leave us with. Do we have the Christ of heaven? So many people, I mean, listen, I've got some really precious Catholic friends, and they really, really, truly believe in the Catholic Church. But I just don't know if he's saved. I just don't know. I really do think that some of these weird, oddball, off the wall places that people can truly, really, truly get saved through Jesus Christ by accident or in spite of, not because of, because God is God and He can move through anything. And he could work through a perverted Bible as well as he can a King James Bible. People say, well, I had one of these kinds of Bibles and I got saved. Well, praise the Lord. I'm glad you did. Now get a good Bible. Amen. And get you a good Bible and you'll learn something. I mean, I'm glad that you got saved through that piece of trash, but it's good that you did that. But, you know, now it's time to get into the Word and do something and learn and get grounded. Amen. My trouble was years ago, for so many years, that I wasn't grounded. I was saved. I knew I was saved. I knew all about the church. I knew all about the Bible. But I didn't have it in here. I had it up here. I was just, it was all knowledge. So, it's not a new problem. It's in the Bible. Same thing happened in the time of Paul. People believe in stuff. Stuff is going to get me through. Stuff is going to save me. But the only stuff that's going to save you, there isn't anything. Just a relationship with Jesus Christ. Same thing as it happened back then happens today. And all these different things goes on all around us. Oh, did you see that Trump came up with a peace plan for Jerusalem today, yesterday and today? I got a text and said, what do you think of that, Brother Keene? And you know what I said? Are you ready to fly? You know what? Every president thinks they have to go over there and make peace. And they have convinced Donald Trump. Donald Trump is a baby Christian. If he is a Christian, I think he's a baby Christian. I think he really truly got saved a couple years ago, but he's a baby Christian. He does. These politicians have convinced him that he has to go over there and make peace because that's what American presidents do. That's everybody all the way back since Jimmy Carter and Ronald Reagan and Bill Clinton had a big. They all thought we was going home in 1998 when Bill Clinton and what's his name from over there flew into Washington D.C. and they were big picture of them shaking hands right there in Washington D.C. They thought that was it. We were going home, but we're still here. So we just don't know, but the Lord is coming. He is coming. Did y'all get all the answers? I went kind of slow. I was hoping you did. Y'all get them? Okay. I got the answers here if you need them. If you'd like to have that for your record, I've got it. I got the cheat sheet up here. Y'all get a copy of the missionary support. Anybody that would like to have one from last year? It's from last year, but it didn't change. Okay. It's the very same thing this year. We didn't change. We didn't add or subtract anything. It's exactly the same budget. And if we can pay all those guys and keep them the way it is, that's good. So we'll just go for that this year. Amen. Keep who we have. That's good. All right. Well, what's to come? We're going to pray tonight. Bring your prayer list with you. And we're going to gather around the altar and pray. And a Wednesday night prayer Bible study, prayer meeting. And so that's what we're going to do right now. Amen.